Good morning. Yeah, I've got the one that wasn't on. That's good. I'll try that again. Good morning. If you guys can hear me and you're in the lobby, come on in. Just a few things before we start today. I wanted to give you guys a little bit of an update as far as what we're doing as ministry-wise in different areas. So every Wednesday night, if you're not aware of this, we have all of our high school and middle school age students here into this room. And that number has grown this semester, thankfully. We've got quite the group on Wednesday nights. And so when they come in here, that's the reason after second service, we ask them to put these chairs up on the wall. That's part of the reason we do that. And we have a lot of fun with them, but that's our Rush ministry, which is 6th to 8th grade. If you have a student in that age range, bring them here. We start at 6:30, but the doors open at 6. They hang out, and we feed them. We have, you know, a lesson. This upcoming Wednesday, we're actually doing a worship night, so part of our awesome worship team is going to be there on Wednesday night and lead worship with them and just have some meaningful time with them. With every week, we have something different, but it ends with small group. It's worthwhile. So that's our Rush, and then our high school ministries that we call Flood. So anyway, that's something we do around here that maybe if you're just a Sunday attender, you don't see. And so it's good for you guys, I think, to be aware of that. Now, couple things with that, different ministry areas. We had our Connect class last week. Our Connect class was our membership class. There was some people that stuck around for that. And then we had some people that signed up for that couldn't come. I just want you to know we'll offer those classes periodically throughout the year. So if you missed this one, catch the next one. But if you have any questions about what we do and why we do it, that's the purpose for that class. It's a really good setting for me to answer those questions. So any of those ministry areas that we talk about, whether it's chairs, people putting up chairs and taking down chairs. All these chairs were put out this morning. If that's something you're looking to plug in to do, there's always room for that. If you have coffee in your hand, tastes good and it's free, that's a ministry too. We love to hand you free coffee. And so if you're interested in plugging in, come talk to me or you can just talk to anyone really, like Paul or any of them. We'd be glad to show you ways that you can get involved. So we do have one event that's upcoming on November the 6th. It's called Fall Fest. This is going to be held at Busy Bees. If you're familiar with the Web Writing Academy that's down here across from the Kirbyville Middle School. On the left-hand side of the road, we're going to have some fire and blow-up houses. We'll keep those separate. And we're going to have those things for the kids. And it's a really great time to get to be plugged in around here and get to know some people that you go to church with. But again, that's Sunday, November the 6th. We'll start at 4:30 and we'll go until it gets to be dark. This morning, we start a new series. And we get a lot of questions about, you know, when we start new series and things like that, but we get really excited about this around here. So we're going to get into a time of worship. Before we do, I'm going to pray, and then we're going to get going here. So we don't pass baskets for our offering on Sunday mornings, but we do take one. So if you if that's something that you do, just know there's some baskets that they're not baskets at all. Sorry, they're boxes on the wall that you can drop your offering in, or you can give those things electronically. But we appreciate y'all. So if you guys would, let's go ahead and bow our heads and pray, start our morning. Heavenly Father, we come to you. We come to you with our hands open, God. We've held on to things all week, and at this point, it's time for us to hand those things to you to allow you to do a work in us. We just thank you so much for this opportunity to come to these doors and to just hear your words and to lift up Jesus' name. God, we thank you, we love you, and it's all these things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hope is the antidote to fear.
What are you afraid of?
For the love of money is the root of all evil.
Do not fear. I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God.
The only thing we have to fear is fear itself.
I love the new song. Love the new song. Anybody else? Man, it's so good. So good. Today we start a new series, as Pastor Colin was saying, called Faith Over Fear. And the title of today's message is Help, I'm Freaking Out Here. Help, I'm Freaking Out Here. I'd love to start today with a guilty pleasure of mine because it's October. And though Christmas is fastly approaching, it's going to be honest before we know it. For some of y'all, though, fall is like Christmas for you, right? You love fall. Like, you get as much enjoyment out of decorating for fall as you do for Christmas. Anybody want to own that? Yes, I knew there were somebody to be here today. I knew it. Some of you, you love the spooky, you know, the spooky side of the month. You know, TV is getting ready to be filled with like scary movies to spook us. Porches will be filled with fake spider webs and giant spiders and things like that. There's going to be talk of haunted houses and corn mazes. And so a guilty pleasure of mine is taking in, looking at, and sharing some pictures of people in haunted houses getting freaked out. You ever look at those? I brought some with me today. That's hilarious. Like, there's no greater friend than the one that leaves you in a haunted house, right? Or the guy that can't protect you. You're like, the girls are like, help us out. And he's like, nope, I'm out. And he's like, hold me. I'm scared. And she's like, literally, hold me. As these pictures prove today, fear does unique and weird things to us, doesn't it? And while it's a little fun to look at how people can get freaked out when they're full of fear, when it comes to real life for you and I, real fear is not so funny, right? As some of us have real fears, and we brought them in with us today, real fears that control us at times in our lives, and we can't let things go. It's the what ifs of life. What if this happens, or what if that happens, and that controls us. And listen, this even for Christians, you love Jesus, you have a relationship with him, but you let certain things control how you feel. And those things are based on fear. And the thought of that thing coming into your life, the thought of that thing coming into your house, that thing, the thought of that thing not happening, a goal that you have, a plan that you have, and it not happening, it controls you. Some Christians can't let go of the past. For some of us, it's that haunted past that we just cannot let go, and it won't let go of us. But for some Bible-toting, Jesus-loving Christian people, they can't let go of a good past. They say things like, but those songs that we used to do in church, they were so good. Why do we have to change them? And we can't let go of the past. We don't want to let it go. There's a fear in letting go of it. And it controls us, how we feel and what we do in life, what we say. We all have fears. We all get scared at times in our lives. And then when we get scared, when we get fear, when we get worried, when we get filled with anxiety, we go to church, right? And people say to us, and they'll say, hey, don't be scared. Don't be worried. And we're like, thank you, Captain Obvious. Why don't you go write a book? Go over there and write a book. And we know, listen, as Christians, we know that the Bible says don't fear, but we also know that there are times in our lives that we get freaked out, right? Whether it's the latest virus on the news, whether it's the stock market report, whether it's a news report, a police report, a medical report, we all get scared. When the things that might happen actually happen, we get scared. And then we step into a church environment and people say, God love them. God bless their hearts, as we say. People will say, oh, if you're fearful, then you must not love Jesus. And today, you and I, we can know that there have been sermons preached about fear all over America from pulpits everywhere. There have been books written about fear, studies done on fear, definitions of fear. We've all heard them, right? But today, I want to share two major ways that the enemy manipulates our fears. Let me give you a quick definition to kick this series off. Fear is this. Fear are two things. This is how the enemy uses fear. First, forgetting God's sovereignty, and second, focus shifting. First, we forget God's sovereignty, and the second thing is focus shifting. Now, I got to be careful when I say focus shifting. Not today, Satan. Not today. Uh-uh. Focus shifting. The enemy uses fear in these two major ways. And I know that I could use a number of different stories from the Bible. Like, we're talking, you know, about fear. Gideon, Ezekiel, Joseph, Peter. Like, I could pick a guy or a person in the Bible or a story in the Bible. But the one that I chose today, I feel it shows us fear in these two ways: forgetting God's sovereignty and focus shifting. The story I'm going to share with you today is from 2 Kings, if you brought your Bibles. 2 Kings, go to the Old Testament, kick it old school, 2 Kings chapter 6. The Bible reminds us to not fear in the Bible over 300 times, says, do not fear. All of them are a reminder, not a rebuke. All of them, over 300 times the Bible says, do not fear, is a reminder that we don't have to live in a constant state of fear in our lives. And if we're living in fear, then we have the opportunity to remember that God is sovereign in all things, and we have an opportunity to shift our focus back. It doesn't, listen, it doesn't change the things around us, right? And when the crisis that we're in today is over, guess what? There will be another crisis right behind it. Be encouraged today. You bet. For the rest of our lives, that will continue to happen. Crisis after crisis. Therefore, we have to decide today how we're going to live. Are we going to live in fear, or are we going to live by faith? And hopefully today, when we leave here, we can all move one step closer to living by faith. And I think this story is going to help us, the story in 2 Kings chapter 6. Let's start in verse 8. Here's how the story starts. It says, when the king of Aram was at war with Israel, he would confer with his officers and say, we will mobilize our forces at such and such a place. Now, it's easy for us as we read this to kind of roll right by many things in what we've read and what we're going to read. So let me kind of break this down for us today. The king of Aram and the king of Israel were at war, two kingdoms at war with each other. And the king of Aram was constantly trying to come up with a new strategy, a new battle, a new attack to attack the kingdom of Israel. And we know that the kingdom of Israel represents God's people. Are you with me? Okay, so now every once in a while, I will meet somebody and they will say something like, I just want a world with no war. And I say, wow, that's a great idea. And in a perfect world, it would be perfect. By the way, we don't live in a perfect world. We live in a fallen world. Not only that, but a world with no war has literally never happened in our entire existence, starting with Cain and Abel. It never happened, ever. There will always be war. We are always at war with someone or something as long as we're alive. Again, be encouraged today, my friends. We always will be. We always have been at war with something or someone. And I want to add this. In the church world, we always hear that God has great plans for us, don't we? We always hear that. Like Jeremiah 29:11, God has plans for you, not to harm you, but to give you a future and a hope. God has plans for you, but so does the enemy. His plan is to steal from you. His plan is to kill you. His plan is to destroy everything about you, and his major weapon in doing so is fear. Fear. We're going to continue in the story in verse 9. It says, but immediately Elisha, the man of God, would warn the king of Israel, do not go near that place, for the Arameans are planning to mobilize their troops there. So the king of Israel would send word to the place indicated by the man of God. Time and again, Elisha warned the king so that he would be on alert there. So check this out. The enemy in this story keeps making plans. He keeps making up these battle strategies, and Elisha, hearing from God, keeps telling the king of Israel the enemy's plans. And so after I read this and I reread this, it reminded me of a time in junior high when a game system came out called Nintendo. Yeah, Nintendo. I don't know if you remember. Some of you do, but it's not like today's games where you can like upgrade and update. No, in this world of Nintendo, the game was the game. It was plastic and you held it in your hand. It's an amazing thing. And if the game stopped working, you would open the door where you put the game and you blew in it. Right? And then you took the game and you blew in the game and you put it back in and it worked. It just worked. We don't know how. It just did. And the game of choice for us junior high dudes, these boys of us, as we had this game system, was Tecmo Bowl. It was a football game. And again, I brought another picture of what Bowl. You had four plays, only four plays. You had on offense, you had four plays to choose from: two run and two pass. You could pass left or pass right. You could run right, run left, or you could run right. Now, a matter of fact, this is the actual, I know I'm letting you in on a secret, but this is the Denver Broncos' actual offense here. This is two run, two pass, that's it. That's all you get. So, and here's the thing about Tecmo Bowl. Here's how this worked. If the defense picked your play that you picked, one of those plays, you had a 25% chance of picking the right play. If the defense picked your play, you were unsuccessful on the offense. You just fell right over where you were. Like, you didn't gain anything. You didn't go anywhere. You were unsuccessful. Here's why I share this story, this silly analogy here. It's happening in this story. Verse 9. But immediately the man of God would warn the king of Israel, "Do not go near that place, for the Arameans are planning to mobilize their troops there." How did he know? He's a prophet of God. He's the man of God. And so God is speaking. It's like in this game, Tecmo Bowl. God was telling the opponent where he was going to go. And God is speaking to Elisha, and he is listening. Verse 10, so the king of Israel would send word to the place indicated by the man of God time and again. Elisha warned the king so that he would be on the alert there. So the king of Aram kept coming up with battle plans and strategies, but God's prophet, Elisha, was telling his king where the king of Aram's army would be. He'd say, "Don't go there, because he's going to be there." And the king was like, "Thank you very much." And so here's what I would love for us to hear today. Even though the enemy has a plan for you and I to steal, kill, and destroy, God knows the enemy's plans. And God's plans are greater for us than the enemy's plans. If we'd only spend more time focusing on the Lord and his plans rather than focusing on our problems, he will lead us away from our problems. That's why Scripture says, "Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one." My question is this: what if right now God is warning us? What if right now in our lives God is saying, "Hey, don't go to that place, because when you go to that place, things don't go well"? What if right now in our lives, God is saying, "Hey, don't look at that status, because every time you look at that person's status, it doesn't help you, it hurts you, so don't do it"? What if God right now is saying, "Hey, don't return that text, because it wouldn't be wise to do so," and we don't do so, and we listen? Please listen. I don't say this from a judgment place, because I struggle with this too. But if we would just listen to the things that God is trying to tell us, he will lead us away and around the enemy's harm for us. Why? Because he knows the enemy's playbook. We need to understand this today about God and about the enemy. There are not two equal forces going at each other. Do you hear what I'm saying? There's this belief, there's this theology called dualism. And unfortunately, many Christians have bought into dualism. Dualism is a belief that Jesus and Satan are constantly in a tug of war. It's like this infinite arm wrestling competition where it's like, "Oh no, who's going to win? Is it going to be Jesus? Is it going to be Satan? Let's get ready to rumble." There's this belief of that. And it's called dualism. It's not true at all. The truth is this: Jesus won. On the cross, Jesus says, "It is finished." I have this band that I wear. It says, "Tetelestai, 33 AD. That's when Jesus finished it on the cross. He said, "It's over. It's done. It's finished. The enemy is defeated." He just kept his playbook, and he still thinks he's in the game, but he's not in the game. God knows his playbook. God is supreme. God is sovereign, and God is in control. God is not up there somewhere switching back between CNN and Fox News, biting his fingernails on the edge of his seat, worrying about how am I going to fix everything. God already has it figured out. He's outside of time. and he knows the enemy's plans, and so he's going to take his plans, and he's going to use it for his glory and for his goodness. You know why? Because that's what God does. And so in this story, God is using Elisha, and he's in control. And then things get even crazier in this story. And we need to remember a couple of things in this story right now. There is a fight for our focus. Write that down today. Everywhere, every day, right now in this room, there is a fight for your focus. We will focus on fear, or we will focus on the faith in who God is and what he will do. It's that simple. There is a fight for our focus. And if you and I are constantly full of fear, it's not because we're focused on God. It's because we're focused on things and situations and circumstances all around us. Which leads us to the second thing we need to remember today. The fight for our focus will determine how we feel and how we function. The fight for our focus will determine how we feel and how we function in life. It's like the pictures that we just looked at of people getting freaked out. When our focus is on the things around us, when everybody else around us is freaking out, it tends to make us freak out, right? We freak out. And our focus determines how we feel and how we function. Yet the worst thing that we can do in life and the worst thing we can do when God has a plan for our lives is freak out. Look at verse 11. It consumes us. The king of Aram became very upset over this. He called his officers together and demanded, "Which of you is a traitor? Who has been informing the king of Israel of my plans?" The king of Aram is like, somebody is telling my strategy. Somebody's giving away all of my plans. Somebody is showing my hands, and I want to know who it is. And I've got to wonder if I was a fly on the wall in this moment. I got to wonder when the king was said this, when he saying this to his people, to his officers, are there guys looking around like maybe eating a biscuit? And they're like, "I just came for the biscuits, man. I don't know who it is." Were guys looking around shrugging, going, it's like my kids when something breaks in my house. Who did this? Wasn't me. It may have been them. Were there guys in this room? Is he going, somebody is a traitor in this room. Guys looking around going, wasn't me, but that guy over there looks kind of sus. I don't know. It's probably him. And the king's like, I've got these great ideas and I've got these great plans, but there's somebody leaking my information. And then something else happens. And when I read this for the first time, I got to be honest, I LOL'd. I laughed out loud when I read this, verse 12. "It's not us, my lord the king," one of the officers replied. "Elisha, the prophet in Israel, tells the king of Israel, even the words you speak in the privacy of your bedroom." So I got to stop here. Because in our culture and in our society, we have front porch talk, then we have living room talk, and then we have bedroom talk, right? Front porch talk kind of goes like this. "What's up, man? Can I help you?" Sure, can I come in? Nope, don't think so. You can stay right there and we'll just have a conversation. That's front porch talk, right? Then you have living room talk, then you have bedroom talk. Hopefully, nobody here is giving a Jehovah's Witness a bedroom tour. Hopefully nobody else is going like, "That's the bed and there's the closet and there's the chair." That would be weird, right? Because that's front porch talk. Front porch talk is just that. It's front porch talk. And then we have living room talk. Living room talk kind of looks like this. "Can I get you anything? You're thirsty? Take your shoes off. Make yourself comfortable. How's the family? Family doing good?" "Yeah, family's doing good." That's living room talk. And then we have bedroom talk. I don't think I need to explain this, right? Good. See, those are all different conversations. And in this story, these officers are telling their king, "Hey, you think that he knows your battle plans. He knows everything in your life, bro." And the king is not happy. Verse 13 says, "Go and find out where he is," the king commanded, "so I can send troops to him." Now, he could have sent a sniper. He could have sent special operations, Navy SEALs, and he could have sent an assassin. No. He sends troops. He sends a whole army. He's like, I don't want anybody knowing my stuff, my bedroom stuff, and so I'm shutting this down. Now, verse 13 says, go and find out where he is, the king commanded, so I can send troops to seize him. And the report came back. Elisha is at Dothan. So one night, the king of Aram sent a great army with many chariots and horses to surround the city where Elisha was. Now, do you think that would be intimidating? If you're Elisha, if you're the king of Israel, and have you ever been in a position in life where you were intimidated? Or a position in life where you felt like you were surrounded by something that felt like the enemy? I have. In the second grade. What? It's the second grade. I remember second grade. Before school, in the second grade, all of our grades, we had this awesome asphalt playground. And you, on this playground, you could play basketball, you could play four square. Remember four square? You could play jump rope, hopscotch. They even had 40-yard dash, like a lines that you would stay in your lane in a 40-yard dash. And so I played a man's game, kickball, because over in the corner they had a kickball, like a baseball diamond, kickball. And one morning we were playing kickball, and the ball was kicked over my head, and I was running after it, and I collided with the group of sixth graders who were running the 40-yard dash. I'm in the second grade. I collide with sixth graders. They are not happy. They yelled at me, get out of our way. You messed our race up. So I yell back at them, well, you messed up our kickball game. This was not real wise of me. This was real. We're talking playground territorial war just happened. So after I popped off my mouth, they are mad. And so we start racing all together, and I'm winning. As to some, I know it might look like that they were chasing me, I know, but that's only because they were chasing me. They were chasing me. I was scared, I was intimidated, I was surrounded by a bunch of mad sixth grade boys. And the leader of this group, his name was Bobby. Bobby was scary. Bobby wore a Motley Crue button, like right here. No shirt, just the button in his bare chest, man. Bobby was a bad dude, and I picked a bad dude to pop off to. And he's chasing me, and as he's chasing me, he's saying, get him. And then more people start. This is like a Rocky movie, okay? Rocky's running, and all the kids are chasing. Yeah, all these kids are chasing me. They don't even know why they're chasing me. They're just yelling, get him. Why? I don't care. Just get him. So they're running after me. And at this point, I don't even know where I'm running to. I'm just running. But then I remember my sixth grade older brother is on the same playground. And so I'm looking back at these dudes, and I'm scared, and I'm surrounded, and I'm intimidated. And when I turn around, I just look up, and there is my older brother. And I grab him, and I hold him tight, and I tell him I love him, and I'm never letting him go. And Bobby and his friends scatter. I was scared. I was intimidated. I was surrounded. I'll never forget it. But now I'm safe. Here's why I share that silly little story. Today I know that Satan is trying to do the same thing to some of you. There are people in this room today, there are people listening online, and you are gripped with fear of something. In some area of your life, you are scared. In some area of your life, you feel surrounded. In some area of your life, you feel intimidated. And I need you to hear this today. The enemy has you on the run, and the enemy has you scared, and the enemy has you intimidated, and here's why. For starters, the enemy sees your potential more clearly than you do. Do you realize that today? The enemy sees your potential more clearly than you do. And if he can shut you down by intimidating you, if he can shut you down by causing fear in you, if he can shut you down by causing you to run, then you will back down from God's plan for your life. Have you ever just stopped and really thought about that? The reason that the enemy is hot on your trail is because he knows if you got in on God's plan for you, you will be unstoppable. And check this out too. The reason the enemy is running us down is because he knows that God is trying to use us to run up the score. The reason he's trying to run us down is because he knows that we're going to run up the score with what God wants to do in our lives. And I would bet that there is someone in here today, and God has called you to step out and do something in faith, and you are terrified. Maybe it's a dream, maybe it's a plan, and you thought, there is no way that I could ever pull that off. And the fear is holding you back from doing it. And I'm telling you right now, if it is truly of God, and you believe that, then how can anyone in this world stop that? If it's truly of God, then in Jesus' name, step out and do it. I would say that there is someone here, or there's somebody listening online, and fear of something runs your life, and you can't stop thinking about it, and you can't shake it, and it literally controls you. And I'm telling you today, in Jesus' name, it no longer has a hold on you. Let it go and feel the freedom that God has for you. Because he is bigger than that thing. He is stronger than that thing. And that thing does not hold you. God's love and his power in your life does. Let it go. Do not fear. For the one that is within us is greater than the one who is in this world. Amen? I didn't say that. 1 John said that. Go read it. Go look it up. Go believe it. Back to the story real quick. In verse 15, it says, when the servant of the man of God, this is Elisha, got up early the next morning and went outside, there were troops, horses, and chariots everywhere. Oh, sir. I bet that's how he said it. I'm just saying, you don't cuss in front of the prophet. I'm just saying. Oh, sir, what will we do now? The young man cried to Elisha. Now, don't you think if anyone should have belief, if anyone should have faith, if anyone should have the confidence in God, shouldn't it be the servant of Elisha, the man of God, his right-hand man? Shouldn't it be the guy who sees these miracles with his own eyes that Elisha is doing and God is using Elisha in? The things, miracles that you and I have never seen or will ever see. You can't get closer to God, to what God is doing, than this guy. He has a front row seat in what God is doing. And so you would think that he'd be a man of faith, right? Not a man of fear. But what we just read, this guy just put his focus on the enemy. And the result was fear. And this proves to all of us that none of us are so godly that we don't deal with fear in our lives. For crying out loud, the disciples of Jesus, guys that hung out with Jesus, they were told a number of times to not be afraid. And Jesus didn't say it as a rebuke to them. He said it as a reminder to them. Why? Because we all have trouble in life that we focus on. We all have times that we forget who God is and how sovereign he is. We forget what he can do. And this guy did too. Because in this moment, troops are surrounding him. Horses and chariots. And this king of Aram brings everything he has to attack Elisha. And again, it serves as a reminder to us that the more the enemy comes at you, the more the enemy brings on you, it just proves that he's just intimidated by Christ in you. Don't ever forget that. Don't ever forget that. Look what happens in verse 16. Don't be afraid, Elisha told him. So while I know that's what Elisha says in this moment and that Elisha is a man of God, I still struggle with this response from people. Do you? Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. I still struggle with that response from people, that moment in my life when I'm worried and I'm in fear and somebody walks up to me and says, hey, don't be afraid. And I'm like, you are so right. You must be a genius or something. When somebody comes to me and says, don't be afraid, you know what happens with me? It tends to make things worse because now I'm afraid that I'm afraid. Are you with me? I get it. I do. Elisha just told his servant, hey, don't be afraid. But then something else happens in this verse. In verse 16, he says, don't be afraid, Elisha told him, for there are more on our side than on theirs. Now, be honest. If you see chariots surrounding you, if you see this army and all these horses, this army all rolls up on you, and the man of God looks at you and says, don't worry, we've got more people than they do. Be honest, you're going to be like, you got into those brownies, didn't you? I told you not to eat those brownies. I told you to stay away. Did you go to Colorado? Like, what are you doing? Those things will make you talk in colors and crazy stuff. And I wonder if the servant looked at Elisha in this moment and said, more? We've got more than they do. Like, I just counted. One, two. Here, I'll do it again. One, two. Well, count backwards. Two, one. Let's double it. One, two, three, four. There's still four versus a whole army. But we get this, don't we? We all, at some point in our lives, and in some capacity, we have dealt with fear. And we've all freaked out. At life, at what goes on in life. But look what happens in verse 17. Then Elisha prayed, oh Lord, open his eyes and let him see. Can we all agree that there is something that happens? There is, when we look at things from a human perspective, when we look at things from a human standpoint, and we have that thing in our lives that causes us to fear. But what if in that moment, what if we all prayed, God, open my eyes. God, open my eyes. Let me see this the way you would see this moment. God, open my eyes. What if we prayed that in those moments? In this story, the servant of Elisha thought that they were going to have to fight. And guess what? It would have been a quick fight. We're talking a 1-2 punch. One punch, you hit the ground. One of the two of them, two down, two done. It's over. Yet Elisha said, you're not seeing this the way God wants you to see this. Elisha prays in this moment, oh Lord, open his eyes and let him see. See, Elisha already saw something that the servant could not see. Verse 17, the Lord opened the young man's eyes, and when he looked up, when he was being chased and he's turned around looking there, but when he looked up, he saw the hillside around Elisha was filled with horses and chariots and fire. See, the servant of God in this moment, he thought, we're surrounded. But what he didn't know was that God surrounded the enemy that surrounded them. Because God is bigger than the enemy. Because God is bigger than that problem, my friend. Because God is bigger than that broken relationship. Because God is bigger than that medical report and what it says. Because God is bigger than that fear. Because God is bigger than that situation. Elisha prayed, open his eyes and let him see. And now he can see. But you know what? This doesn't mean that the enemy is still not coming, does it? Because they are. The story is not over. The battle has just begun. The armies are there. They're lined up. Verse 18, as the Aramean army advanced toward him, Elisha prayed, O Lord, please make them blind. He prayed a four-word prayer. Please make them blind. And sometimes for us in that moment, in that crisis, in that fear, that's all we have time for, isn't it? Please help me, Lord. Please hear my prayer. I'm freaking out here. Listen, prayer is not about quantity. Prayer is about quality. And myself, I will choose honesty over hypocrisy any day. So my advice to you is if you're scared, pray scared. Help God, I'm freaking out. Please hear my prayer. Elisha, he knows. He knows what God can do. And you know what? God knows when we're scared. He's here. He hears you. Elisha prayed, please make them blind. Verse 18, so the Lord struck them with blindness as Elisha had asked. And the thing that caused fear in the heart and the soul of the servant of the man of God became a stepping stone of his faith. Instantly, he was reminded of who God was and what he could do. Instantly, he was reminded just how big of a God God is and what he was capable of doing in this moment. Instantly, his focus is restored. And so today, I want to help you with that too. Here's a prayer that I've been praying. I want to help you with this prayer. The band's going to come out. Band, you guys can go ahead and come out. We're going to sing a song, but I want to show you this prayer. I've been praying this prayer lately in my life, because I've been anxious, I've been burnt out, I'm tired, I'm exhausted. So I pray this prayer. I'm scared, and I pray this prayer. Lord, help me not to fear. Help me to not fear and know you are here. I want to give you permission this week to pray that prayer in your moment of fear. Lord, help me to not fear and know you are here. I love that song. Spoiler alert, we're going to sing it in just a second. Roxy's going to lead us in it. I love that song that says, it may look like I'm surrounded, but I'm surrounded by you. And then the words are, this is how I fight my battles. You want to know how I fight my battles? You know, want to know the best way to fight your battles? The posture of surrender. I can worry. I can fear. I can have anxiety, or I can surrender. My hope for you today, could you stand with me today? My hope today is that we can embrace this. Lord, help me to not fear and know that you are here. And today we can stand in a posture of surrender, knowing the battle is not ours, the battle is his. Right. He's in the battle with us. And we're going to sing this song today.